Introduction.
I'll do the presentation standing with the mic. So.
Nesse aqui? Tá vendo? Você tirou, né? Ok. Joia. Very good description from Claudio e Miguel lá fora.
É.
Outro nível, né? Pena que a gente não é assim, né? Eu podia ser assim, né? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Let's start the final afternoon section. I know pão de queijo is very good, but if you could... No? Good afternoon. Maybe we should start again, please, ladies and gentlemen, have your seat. Okay? Okay, can you listen to me now? Marina, fecha a porta lá que aí a gente começa, por favor. Okay, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming back. We're going to start the last session of the day. So it is my pleasure to invite Professor Dick Atema to join us for the talk now. Dick Atema is Associate Professor at the Faculty of Geosciences in the Department of Human Geography and Planning at the Utrecht University. He holds a PhD from the Eindhoven University of Technology, and has conducted research on time use related to travel and travel choice since the early 1990s. His research interests include agent-based modeling or firm and household-related processes. Other interests include the analysis of activity and time use patterns and the implications of travel and activity behavior for individuals' well-being. So thank you very much, Dick. You have 40 minutes. Thank you.
Okay, that seems to work. Thank you, Bernardo, for the introduction and for having me here. It's a real pleasure to be in this very interesting seminar. Well, as you know, I'm going to talk about transportation planning, and listening to the excellent presentation so far, I feel a little bit like an odd one out, in the sense that I'm from a transportation background, and most people here seem to be from a complex system background. And listening to the presentation so far, I was thinking how I could position this presentation and how I could connect to the other presentations, which I will try to do in the remainder. But one way to look at my presentation, I guess, is as a sort of a case study to see how complex systems are applied in a particular discipline, in this case transportation. And some observations can be made there. One observation is, and it relates to my first remark, is that transportation modeling community and the complex system analysis community have been quite separated, which is maybe a bit surprising. So the first example given of a complex system today was about transportation. It was about congestion and the feedback of that aggregate effect to individual behavior. So transportation planners and transportation modelers have been building and applying complex systems for 3 or 4 decades, but still they do not relate so much to the complex system community. That's the first one. The second is that the transportation modeling community is quite institutionalized in the sense that you could say there is a sort of a cookbook of how to do transportation modeling. It has developed over the years, but if you go to cities around the world, you will find that transportation modeling takes place everywhere, but more or less based on the same principles and using the same kind of techniques, not only on the level of national authorities, but also within municipalities, meaning that consultants and officials in those municipalities are quite familiar with how it's done. So maybe that's a different context, which says something about how models could be applied. Third one is that there was talk about, well, how should you use complex system models? You should not use them for point predictions. Well, exactly what we try to do in transportation. A city planner or an infrastructure planner is not interested in information that car traffic will increase somewhere between 50 and 100%, because with a 50% increase, there may be not a problem at all, and with 100%, there may be a lot of congestion. So in the specific context of transportation, it is about predictions often, about exact predictions, because very concrete predictions are made. Final one, I listened to the previous presentations with much interest and a particularly interesting statement, and I was also provoked by that, is that transportation problems are rather simple and that you could solve them with quite simple techniques. So maybe I need to talk to Luis after this presentation, because I've been working on that for 20 years or so. I think it depends on where you draw the boundary of the system, but also depending on the aim of the policy and of the field. So if you see the aim of transportation planning as getting a number of cars on a given trajectory without having congestion, okay, that could be rather simple. But if you define the aim of transportation planning as facilitating people to participate in the activities that they want to do, to live in a place they find acceptable, to maintain their social networks, it becomes slightly more complicated. And that's more or less the message that I will try to convey. You can look at transportation planning on different levels of scale, on different levels of complexity, and it depends on your policy goals, how you should treat it. So basically, that's what I will do. This is the contents of my presentation. I will give a sort of an overview as a sort of a case study or an ethnographic study, if you will, of application of complex systems in transportation. I will first more generally talk about transportation systems and their elements and how that relates to complexity. Then I will cover different traffic or travel models, depending on the scale, with increasing complexity being traffic simulation model, which is basically what Bill showed us an example of in the first presentation. Then travel demand models, which include a wider range of behaviors. And finally, land use transport interaction models. I will focus mostly on the last category because it's the most complex one, so maybe therefore more challenging and more open for discussion of how to do this. So of these LUTI models, land use transport interaction models, I will give examples of applications, more applied and more conceptual or toy models, to give you some idea of the type of interactions that could be covered and how you could do that. I will relate that to societal issues and how they can be addressed by complex transportation methods, and finish off with some conclusions. Okay, if you look at the transportation system, you can identify three layers. Basically, the most simple one is about traffic simulation. That's basically when you talk about a number of vehicles on a particular trajectory and modeling their behavior. And under the assumption that the origin and the destination of the trips are all given, you could extend the boundary of the system a bit more and address it with the travel demand forecasting models. These models include also traffic flows and route choice, but also decisions about whether to make a trip at all, by what mode to make the trip, and about the destination where you go to. So a wider range of policy options and the larger scale land use transport interaction includes also longer term decisions such as car ownership, whether or not to work and how frequent, where to work, where to reside, demographic events, etc., etc. So that's a situation where daily travel, which is covered by the travel demand forecasting model and traffic simulation model, is embedded in a system that describes more longer-term decisions. I'll come to the other points later on in the presentation. A few words maybe about complexity. I'm afraid I'm already a little behind of schedule, so I'll try to keep it brief. I'm not from the complex systems arena, as I said. I looked in an article by Steve Manson in 2001 where he distinguished different types of complexity. Algorithmic complexity, which has to do with the complexity of the algorithms, of the behavioral rules and the interactions you need to describe a system. Deterministic complexity, which has to do with the idea that complex systems can develop in different directions. They can develop in the direction of attractors, certain states in a complex system that are more likely to occur. Bifurcation, the fact that a system goes back and forth between different states and totally chaotic behavior. That's not so much addressed in transportation planning. It has been said before that in transportation planning we often like to work with models that more or less tend to an equilibrium. Even if they're not formally equilibrium models, also the simulations tend to a certain equilibrium. I only know a few papers that have dealt with chaotic behavior and bifurcation in the context of traffic flow modeling. Third type of complexity is aggregate complexity, which has to do with the fact that a complex system is made up by agents, that they are connected in structures, that there are interactions, that agents have goals that they try to achieve and behavioral rules that describe how they get there, etc., leading to emergence and self-organization, and leading to, on the system level, issues like dissipation and part dependency, tipping points, etc., which is very much in line with what has been discussed earlier today. And most of the complexity in transportation systems, at least as it appears in the models that are used today, has to do with aggregate complexity. How do individual actions, when aggregated, change the state of the system, and how does feedback from that aggregated state change the behavior of the individual agents in the system? That's the basic type of complexity that I will be talking about. Okay, if you talk about traffic simulation models, and Bill gave a first introduction of that this morning, you basically regard cars as being the agents, and their behavior is relatively simple in most models. The origin and the destination of these vehicles, of these cars, is given. It could be even a linear model where you have one road where they go from the beginning to the end of the road. So the number of cars is given, the departure times are given, and you can simulate them in a model like Bill was showing, but there are also very fancy software packages like Paramix, where this still is from, that simulate how cars run on the network. And to do that, they have certain behavioral rules They have a speed that they try to maintain. They have a following distance, a minimum distance they have to keep from their the car before them. They have decision rules about which lane to choose. The more advanced models also look at route choice. And that already makes a bit more a responsive system. So if a car and the driver in that car experience congestion, he may or she may decide not only to change lane or to change speed, but also to consider another route. The structure connecting these agents, of course, is the network, the road network, with certain capacity in terms of the number of cars and the number of lanes, and by the responses of the individual drivers that leads to changes in speed on the network. Signaling is also included in those models, so you could even regard traffic lights or ramp meters as agents that receive information about the presence and the number of cars, and based on that give different signals in a deterministic way. Yeah, the models are dynamic on a second-by-second scale, more or less, you could say. And that means that you can follow the state of the system from second to second in illustrations like that, in movie clips like that. Well, what about complexity in these models? It has been said before. There's aggregation in these models. So an accumulation of cars that have to maintain a certain distance leads to changes in speed and in the end to congestion. The cars may emit hazardous gases or unhealthy stuff, emissions, which can also be modeled in models like this. There is interaction between cars by these car following rules within the structure of the road networks. So there are certain feedback mechanisms that lead to changes in speed, changes in lane, and changes in route. And yeah, you could say that models like these are indeed rather simple because you have cars that have fairly straightforward rules. So indeed you might solve this quite easily. But it might also be more complicated, and I think that's where the discussion in transportation modeling often is about. How much behavioral complexity do you want to enter into your models? For instance, the cars and the drivers may have imperfect knowledge. They may not have sufficient information about travel time on different routes if they are allowed to choose a different route. So you could also extend the models in such a way that drivers, by experimenting, learn about travel times on different routes and update their knowledge. So then it becomes slightly more complex if you want to do that. But maybe that's relevant also in the context of policies such as giving drivers information about the state of the network, and you may need to model how drivers process that information if you are interested in the evaluation of traffic information to solve congestion. So depending on the type of policies, depending on the behavioral detail that is needed to address those policies, they may already become quite complicated. And it means that also a lot of research is needed on the level of individual car drivers and individual the car drivers on their behavior. If the system is to give reliable outcomes, the behavioral rules on the individual level should be right. So it means that you have to investigate that. You have to put people in simulators or put them into experiments to see how they respond. So in that sense, and we will see that also later on, agent-based systems may also, if you refine them, give rise to behavioral research, and that's what happens quite a bit in our field. Okay, if we extend the scale of our traffic modeling, we come at travel demand forecasting models, and, well, basically, it means that we are not only looking at cars on the road and their routes and the speeds, etc., but we also acknowledge that individuals may have other choices. They may not necessarily go by car, they may use other travel modes, so we have to look at mode choice. The destination of the trip may not always be given, so people make conscious decisions about where to go, and they also need to decide whether to go in the first place. So if you implement policies, or if autonomous events happen, like the congestion is increasing, people not only respond by changing their route or their speed, they may also make decisions in the other domains. Well, that has long been acknowledged in so-called four steps models, and they have been implemented in transportation planning since the 1960s, 1970s, and in many places they are still in operation. So what is the structure of these models? Essentially, it's a spatial structure, so you have a system of zones, and in each zones certain people live with different characteristics, of different type of households, young people, old people, single people, people with children, etc. And these people may decide whether to make a trip, if they make a trip, well, for what purpose the trip is made, for instance, to go swimming or to go to work. They need to decide where to do that. For work, it's probably given, but for recreational activities, there are multiple choices. And they also need to decide by what mode. So that's basically what happens in these models. How is it done? The way it is typically done is by using discrete choice models. And discrete choice models are econometric models that describe, according to a principle of utility maximization, what alternative people will choose. So the trip by car has a certain utility based on the travel time and the travel cost, etc. Same for public transport or for cycling. And based on that, people will make their choice. And again, if you apply these models in a forecasting model, in a simulation, they first need to be calibrated on the individual level. So what typically happens is that you observe the choices people make, you analyze the alternatives they have and the characteristics of the alternatives, the attributes, and there are standardized ways to estimate the parameters of your model in the utility function. This is very common practice in transportation modeling, and someone like Dan McFadden is one of the founders of that. He won a Nobel Prize in 2000, and much of the research in transportation is about discrete choice modeling, and these discrete choice models are later applied in modeling systems. Okay, how is that done? Basically, what is done is that for each type of person or each type of household in a particular zone, first you run a trip generation model, so you know a number of X leisure trips are made. Then you run a mode choice model, saying that, okay, so many percent of the recreational trips is made by car, so many by bus, etc. And following that, you have a destination choice model. So these individual choice models are applied on a population in each zone to generate trips by mode and by destination. The application can be based, can be done on a semi-aggregate level, so you partition the population into household classes, and for each household class you make a distribution, or it can be fully disaggregate, then you have an agent-based model. So for each agent in your model, you run these discrete choice models, you apply them, so for each person you have a simulation of the trip that this person makes. How about complexity? Again, here you also have aggregated effects. The trips that people make between the zones are loaded on some underlying network. On that level, traffic loads are confronted with the network capacity. leading to changes in travel time in case there is congestion, and these changes in travel time may in turn influence people's decisions. So if it's too crowded on the road and travel time is very long, maybe you may decide to take the bicycle or public transport. So in an iterative way, the trip generation mode and destination models and the traffic assignment are run over and over again until you get some kind of equilibrium. So that's the level of complexity. So it's basically about congestion on the road network. These models are cross-sectional models, so you cannot follow the development over time, even if you are interested in what will happen on the road in 20 years, if the population has changed, if the road network has changed. You are not modeling how it will develop from year to year, but in one effort, you create a situation in 2020, and that's it. Typically, it's on the level of one day or for one period of the day, typically the peak period. An extension that has been developed over the past years are so-called activity-based models. Given the time, I will not go in too much depth into that. But the idea there is that different activities and different trips that people make throughout the day are interrelated. So you're not just making a random trip to a swimming pool or so. No, the idea is that you first try to understand what type of activities people want to engage in, and then you try to reconstruct what type of travel is needed to make possible these activities. But also, these models look at the sequence in which activities are taking place. So an activity schedule for a whole day is constructed, and that determines what trips are made. And that raises issues like trip chaining. So for instance, if someone first decides to go swimming, then to work, and then back home, it has implications for timing. If your work starts at 9, the trip to the swimming pool will be made before that. It may have implications for mode choice, because of the first part of this trip chain is made by car, the rest also has to be made by car. Another aspect of these models are household interactions. These models are applied on the household level, so they also address issues as task allocation. Who will drop off the kids today? Who will do the shopping today? So in that sense, they are more responsive to certain policies. Well, the idea behind that is that increasing complexity of society, changing roles of men and women in households, changes in the flexibility of time regimes can only be properly addressed if the timing aspect and the interrelatedness of these activities is addressed. So I think that's an important observation, that if you have a complex model like a transportation model, it may be necessary to update the behavioral component on a particular level if the outside world changes. It would be nonsense to ignore these effects and still assume that everything happens like in the 60s, where one person in the household, the man, went to work, and another person, the woman, did the shopping, for instance. So to get more reliable outcomes, you need to account for those issues. And these models are operational today, at least in the United States and Europe, and I think they are beginning to appear also in other places. Good. If we broaden the scope a little bit further, we come to land use transport interaction models. And these type of models have been around for quite some time, but a shift has taken place somewhere in the 1990s from economic input-output type of models, equilibrium models, that also looked at interactions between land use and transportation, to micro-simulation model, agent-based models that describe basically the same type of processes, but in a much more flexible way. Well, common examples, well-known examples are the Urban Sim model by Paul Waddell, ILUT by Eric Miller, and ILUMAS by Michael Wegener in Dortmund. And basically what these models do is that they include up and above the daily travel behavior, the behavior of households in terms of demographic events, aging, children being born, household formation, etc., relocation, work status, job location, car ownership. They include a representation of firms, and this is all on the agent level, so a model would contain a representation of individual households consisting of a number of individuals, individual firms that have behavior like creating jobs or deleting jobs, or go bankrupt, or go to another place. Developers, in a broad sense, agents that may take decisions about land use change, about housing and real estate. And the idea is that transportation on the one hand and all these decisions on the other hand are interrelated. Well, in one way, of course, it's easy to see. Maybe I should go to my next slide already, because it has to do with long-term and short-term interactions. If you have this representation of the individual agents, which also include dwellings, so you have households living in dwellings, which are also, let's say, an array in your computer code with certain characteristics, workplaces of different types, and a road network, where people live, what their work status is, what their household composition is, will define what activities they will engage in, what destinations they will go to. So you could feed that into a travel demand model or an activity-based travel demand model and get the trips. We have said before that if you make, if you do that, the basic aggregation is, if you load that on the network, it may lead to congestion, it may lead to changes in accessibility and travel time, and those changes may give rise to changes on these longer term dimensions. So if congestion worsens and your commute, your daily commute takes longer and longer, you may decide to look for another job or to look for another place to live or to buy, well, that's not a good example, or to get rid of your car, for instance. So it's that kind of interactions that land use transport interaction models are trying to predict and insert or predict, at least describe. And in certain instances, it's very clear that these interactions take place. And, well, I come to that later, but I say it right away. But urban sprawl, of course, is point in case of this type of interaction. Not represented here, but cars and owned by households should also be in the system. If more people buy a car, their accessibility will go up. They can afford to live in other places. Therefore, they may need to use their car because they go to suburban places. Firms and retailers may respond to that by also relocating. So you get a change in the system, and also developers will develop housing in places that are accessible by car, and gradually you move to a situation where you have a car-dependent system, as has happened in many places in Europe and particularly in the US. And it's those kind of travel and long-term decision interactions that are well described by these LUTI models. The agents I have discussed already. It means in terms of behavior that a much wider range of behavior needs to be described. For demographic processes and work status, etc., but also on the firm side, usually probability distributions are used from demographic data. So a person of a certain age has a certain probability to get married in a particular year, given that he or she is not married yet. Decisions of agents about relocation, of job location, about land development, they are usually described by this discrete choice model, meaning that you have to observe households' decision whether or not to locate and where to go, where accessibility considerations can be one of the explanatory factors. You need to have a representation of markets, as I will show later on. There can be more traditional, like a hedonic regression to represent prices, but you can also have more complicated models of negotiation between someone who wants to buy a house and someone who wants to sell a house, etc. So it means that a lot more detail is needed, and that you need to not only define the structure, but especially develop the models of individual behavior. And one important observation is that the spatial dimension is a particularly complicating factor, making these models so complex. If you have a simulation model of a market, and a market is not spatial, you could say that it's still relatively straightforward. If you want to model a spatial process like land use development in a cellular automata, where each cell only is influenced by its neighbors or two cells ahead, it's still doable. But it's particularly difficult if you have a spatial system in which agents are allowed to freely move through space, experience congestion in different places, but also in longer-term decisions. If you have a system of 1,000 zones or a million dwellings in a particular place, modeling which dwelling will be bought is not so easy. For instance, if one condition is that my new dwelling should be close to at least one supermarket within 100 meters, that's something that we can easily decide in real life and find out. If you want to model it in a model and represent it, it's really complicated because of the enumeration issues involved, and also because of the fact that the model is dynamic, things change from year to year, so accessibility will also change from year to year. Particular important are the interactions between agents, and they happen in two ways. One is the direct interaction, such as the housing market, on the labor market. You have one person who wants to sell a house, another who wants to buy it. You have a labor market where a firm has a job to offer and an employee wants to have it, and they negotiate whether there is a match. The marriage market, of course, also, it's basically a question of matchmaking in a sort of probabilistic way. But still, if you want to do that in a detailed way, it's already quite complicated. You also have these indirect aggregate effects. Congestion, I already mentioned. But if you are modeling housing markets as part of your land use transport interaction model, that's also something to consider. If many people want to live in a certain place, prices will go up, and that will also influence where people want to live. If the composition of the neighborhood changes, that may also influence people's location choice. So there are different aggregate effects here that will influence people's decision making. So it's about travel times, but also about prices. How much time have I left? 15 minutes or so?
10.
Okay. Try to do that. I wanted to give just a few examples that I came across in the literature. One was a paper by Erdogan et al., which is about the effect of fuel prices. And they have a model, hope you can read it, consisting of a land use model and a transportation model that interact in a way as I just explained. And they evaluated scenarios in which fuel prices might go up by a certain percentage. I will only do the base case, which is this one. This is a picture of residential density. And this is a picture of the change in density. And what you see is that with increasing fuel prices, people choose to live more near the existing centers of residents and of facilities, etc. So densities will go up if transportation becomes more more expensive. That's logical, but it requires that your land use model and the model of where development takes place and where people will go accounts for that. This is traffic loads on the network and the change in that. And what you see is that due to the increasing fuel prices, people will travel less, so traffic intensities will go down. But in certain places, especially in the central areas, because of the concentration, still you will have higher densities, traffic densities. So that's an illustration that these short-term and long-term effects may interact with each other and lead to particular outcomes. And if you would ignore the urban development and relocation part, you would have biased outcomes. For the sake of time, I will do this one.
Go ahead.
Okay. This is more like a toy model, I have to admit. A study that we did in the corridor between Amsterdam, the capital, and Almere, which is a satellite town. And what we did was a model that described where people choose to work in Almere or in Amsterdam, but also how they would spend their money, on what kind of activities, and how much they would travel. And it is important that the jobs in Amsterdam were assumed to pay a higher wage, 2% higher. So people would make a trade-off between whether to go to Amsterdam, have more money, but spend more time on traveling, and therefore, having a less pleasant life, spending less time on recreation and family activities. And we have had some variants, for instance, if we make travel more expensive or if incomes in Amsterdam would pay the same as in Almere. And you see that people make different trade-offs in that respect. So if they cannot make more money in Amsterdam, why go there? So they will just stay in Almere. They will spend more time on activities there and be better off. So just one example of that, for instance, also income and how you spend your income on activities might be included in those kind of models. This one, a study by Jackson, 2008, Jackson et al., which was about gentrification in Boston. And agents in this study were different type of households, professionals, non-professionals with a lower income, students and elderly. And basically what happened was that people responded to the rent basically on two things. They wanted to live near jobs and amenities, so that would be a trigger to live in a certain area. But also, if the rent became too high, they had to leave the neighborhood. And the rent, in turn, depended on the percentage of high-income professionals. So if the neighborhood became fancier and more popular, rents would go up. And they showed that in a dynamic simulation, year to year, or at least time step to time step, these processes, so the individual decisions about where to live and the aggregate effect of the rent increasing, leads to a lower and decreasing share of non-professionals, where the share of professionals more or less stays the same. So also in terms of urban development, but also social composition of neighborhoods, these models can have their value. Okay, I think I will skip a few slides here, otherwise I don't have time for my conclusions. Impacts for city and society. On one hand, it's quite straightforward. If you talk about transportation models, they are just used in a particular way. They are used to predict traffic flows, and based on that you get information about congestion, about travel time. You can use them to make forecasts with, if you couple models with them, about pollution and noise. Information about travel times may tell you something about quality of life. The more complex activity-based models may also give an indication of time use and activity participation. So that's the sort of information you can get out of those models if you want to analyze policies. In the land use transportation models, it's a much wider range of issues you could potentially address. I listed a few basically in terms of causal chains of what might happen in an urban system. Rising incomes and car ownership. I mean, the example of China has been mentioned before, leading to higher car ownership. People can afford a car. If their income increases, they have a higher housing aspiration. They want to live in a fancier place. They can combine that by going to a suburban location. Well, as I explained before, other actors will respond to that, and you tend toward a car-oriented neighborhood. And that's something which you could describe with land use transport interaction models. And in particular, the bold terms are the parts where policymakers might intervene. They could make sure that job accessibility is not only good by car, but also by transportation systems, and try to stimulate transit-oriented development by zoning restrictions, which is maybe easier in certain societies than in others. They might make sure that there's at least some kind of clustering in the suburban development, leading to better opportunities for public transport. Well, with a model like a land use transport interaction model, an agent-based model, you could get an idea of how successful such policies might need as a result of all these interacting behaviors. You could think of expanding cities. I read something about London, which is projected to grow considerably over the next decades. They extend the city very much to the east, but without taking care of facilities and good public transport. So a traffic model would tell you just that these people have very long commutes, but if you do it with a land use transport interaction model, you might also include decisions about people finding another job, land use developers or commercial development coming into the new neighborhoods because there is a market, etc. The same for shrinking regions, which is an issue in also in certain places in the Netherlands, but also in former East Germany. For instance, there's not only growth in the world, but also shrinkage. You could model that as an outcome of demographic processes with young people, high educated people moving out, populations decreasing, firms and institutions responding to that by relocating to other places or closing down. And in the end, you could have an idea about what it means in terms of reduced accessibility, in particular for certain vulnerable groups and their quality of life. Yeah, if you think a bit further, ICTs, I think some people today mentioned new development, the importance of behavior and psychology. Yeah, ICTs, of course, also might have an effect on transport and also on land use even. In geography, some scholars, let's say 20 years ago or so, would write about the death of distance. You can use everything through the internet in a digital way, so why leave the home anyway? Well, that of course hasn't happened. There are many reasons why we still want to go out and see other people and do stuff. But one of the things is that, for instance, ICTs change the way we organize work. We may work from home a couple of times a week. We may work in transit, and that may lead us to accept longer commute distance, and that may accept where we choose to work or where we choose to live. Do we want to enter that into our models? Is that necessary? Teleshopping, same thing. it changes our shopping behavior, but it may also have an effect on people visiting brick and mortar shops, and as a result of that, these shops may disappear, leading to reduced accessibility for people who, for whatever reason, do not want to shop via the internet. Electric vehicles, not so much models yet. There are market diffusion models, but if you do it in the transportation and land use context, you could also look at the spatial aspect of it. For instance, well, this was what triggered me, the message that Tesla in China, Unicom, made an agreement to build car charging outlets in China. So what will happen if you have more outlets? Accessibility by electric vehicles may increase, but of course it also depends on people's travel behavior, on their activity patterns, so you may want to integrate that with an activity-based model. It may have impact on people buying electric vehicles, things like that may have an impact on the price. Social influence may play a role. If more other people have electric vehicles, you may also want to have one, etc., etc. So there are a lot of new developments that could potentially enter into transport and land use models, also applying agent-based models. Conclusions and discussions. First one, obvious one, land use transposition system is a complex system. I think I made clear that there are many interactions between agents. There are several feedback effects which could lead to outcomes that are different from what we expected. I think agent-based traffic, travel and land use models can be used to represent or study these complex effects, and something to discuss maybe is the way in which to do this. And particularly, the models are also quite flexible, so they are often built up in a modular way. So you could say, well, if something changes in for instance, the type of cars, you can only change that component, and maybe you have to add agents in the sense of charging stations to your model, but the rest could stay intact. So that's an attractive property. You could say that agent-based models may deliver valuable insights. I formulated that a bit carefully, in the sense that they account for this feedback effects, secondary effects that might become game changers. So the effect of car ownership is not so much that people will be faster in their work, but at their work, but mainly that we are moving towards a car-dependent system. We can gain insight in processes. We can gain insight in issues like path dependency, as compared to a situation where we just project in one step the situation 10 or 20 years ahead. We may be able to make statements about the order of magnitude of effects, about tipping points in the system, how many outlets do I, for electric vehicles, do I have to plan in order for the whole development to really take off. You get an insight in what are relevant policy options. I think those aspects have been mentioned by others already. Also, illustration and visualization may be very attractive properties of these models. I noted that myself when I, in consulting, used a package like Paramix, where you actually see the cars being driven on the road, and the policymakers are directly impressed, and they're just taking everything from you, more or less. So you could say that's a pro, but it's also a caveat. They have to really understand what's going on. You can visualize it, but it can also be misleading, of course. So you have to do that in a responsible way. But there's always a but, and this is a tautological conclusion. Modeling complexity is complex. That's also why I started doing it, but at some point I stopped doing it. It takes really a lot of time and effort, at least in the way it's done in transportation. Maybe that's a point of discussion. There's two quotes there of people from this land use transport community about the downward spiral of ever-increasing complexity. I don't know if he remembers having said that, but he did, which is that for every refinement in your model, a new problem will come up that you also have to model. And the question is, how far do you want to go there? If you say that leisure activities are typically difficult to model in transportation, you can say, okay, we can do that better if we also model people's social networks. Okay, we can do that, and based on that, we model that two friends decide to go out for to have a drink, but maybe in the bar they meet someone else that they also become friends with. So theoretically, you can go further and further and further in these models. Michael Wegener called that building a one-to-one Spitfire model. So if you build this small model of a Spitfire plane, it looks like a Spitfire plane, but it lacks a lot of details. And if you keep adding on detail, you have a one-to-one model and you have the actual plane. So we probably do not want to have a replication of the world inside our computer. I mean, that's not what we want, and it's not feasible, of course, in the first place. So that's important, and people in the transportation community, I said, are mostly interested in point predictions, so they want to get it very precisely, and also policymakers who are used to working with transportation and traffic model may expect something like that and may ask for them. So the question is if you want to go along with that, or whether you would say, well, at some point this is where we leave it, this is the amount of complexity that we think is meaningful. Because you end in quite a few problems. So calibration is important. So if you get more behavior in your model, each individual model of behavior, each model of individual rules should be correct. But also the interactions you need to describe in a market or something according to some rules. You need also to develop that, and that also needs to be tested and needs to be proper. And every error that you make gets propagated in the system. So if you make an error in this part, an error in that part, in the end, it doesn't make sense anymore. There's also an issue about tractability. If you make the model too complex and you see different outcomes between one scenario and another, you need to be able to track down what caused that difference. Was it because of a difference in household location decision? Was it because of a difference in travel mode choice? That's also important. And you may lose track if you make it too complex. Data availability, yeah, I'll leave that for now. So that brings me to my final remarks, some issues to be addressed. And particularly important also maybe in the context of some remarks made earlier by Einstein saying that, well, keep your model as simple as possible. Well, transportation people in land use transport modeling basically go the other way. And I think it also has to do with what policymakers want and expect from them. So maybe they need to discuss that. It has to do with what type of outputs do you expect? Do you want to have exact forecast? Is it about the argumentation? Is it about insight in the process, sensitivity analysis? Maybe we need to deal in another way with these very, very complex models. I once was in a workshop about travel modeling and how that should proceed, and although I spent 20 years in transportation modeling, I made the statement there that, well, why don't we stop modeling? I mean, why should we make it more and more complex? We have now a society where we monitor everything. We have sensors everywhere. People have smartphones. We can get in touch with people. They give their opinions. So why not have simple models to have some kind of idea of where we are going and just monitor the system and then react if things go wrong, like with the Google car? In a very simple and determined way. So I think that's an important discussion in the land use transport community area that should take place. So with that, I would like to close. I would like to thank you for staying here the end of the afternoon. if you have questions, I would be happy to hear them. And that's where you can find me. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dick. I'd like to invite again Cleandre to make some comments, but I'll advance some comments on my own while Cleandre gets here. So I was very glad the way that we divided the sessions today, because we started very general. Bill gave some concepts, tried to pin down some models, but it was in the abstract sense. And then Lewis talks about cities in a general way, and also comes a little bit about theory, but it's in a larger scale. And then, Dick, it's very good that you start your presentation saying that it's a case study, right? So we are getting down to earth here. It's a practical thing that people is actually using. So I was very glad for this sequence of contributions. Thank you very much. So my question is, just before Cleandre's comments, is this, can we say that then complex system in transportation is mainstream? Because in economics and all the other disciplines, we're still convincing, we're still justifying. Is it mainstream? You talked about being around since the 60s and the 70s. Yeah. Where are the places that these models by Paul Waddell and the other one, do they affect policy? A second thing you brought, we've been discussing today. We talked about probabilistic models. Miguel talks a little bit about the space of phases of results, and then you come with predictions, exact position predictions. So how exact are they, and how are they handling this error? A third thing that is very important, I think, is that it's important for us to understand transport, because we talked a lot about agents interacting. Lewis talked about the richness of cities' diversity because it's where people meet. That's the insight of Jane Jacobs, right? And then transport facilitates these people to interact or not. Another point I think it's important to highlight in your talk is that you talked about utility maximization, you talk about discrete choice econometrics. So this is a thing people here are familiar with. So you see, we may not have all this distance to go through from what we do in regular basis and what is doing in a typical complex systems transportation modeling. A fourth thing I liked about your talk is because it's actual couple modeling. When I talked this morning, you may have wondered that I was doing some philosophy or Harry Potter wizardry or something. But no, he actually talked about fuel emission and transport and household. And then he connect. I remember Carlos Henrique and I tried to do a paper some time ago, and we tried to put together this effect. So you did what we were asking, which is coupling models so that we can understand cross effect of policies. And I was very glad you talked about that. Another thing, you talked about iterative decision feedbacks, and then you talked about equilibrium. And this is something that I think people who came to watch this seminar should keep in mind. Earlier today, Bernard Miller talked about economics not being in equilibrium, market not being in exact equilibrium, and he's very right about that. But what we have learned from transportation models is that there is some steady states that they tend to move in. So we can have equilibrium, we can have out of equilibrium. And then a fifth thing, I like it very much, is that you talked about this. We have to make a decision about the right size of the model. And that's really tough. That's very difficult. And then we have to decide when, and it was kind of present in the quotation of Lewis, it is we have to benefit, to balance a little bit the benefits of modeling and the costs of inputting hours and hours and hours and data and computer simulation so that we can have a good model. So thank you very much for your talk, Dick. I'll just pass on the word to Cleandre. It's not that we like Cleandre very much, we do, but it's just because it's about urban day, and then he's the urban expert around. Thank you very much, Cleandre.
Thank you, Bernardo. Thank you, Dick, for your presentation. Well, this is the second time which I had the chance to read the paper before commenting here. And in this case, I would also like to thank my colleague, Carlos Henrique Carvalho, for reading and making his comments. Obrigado, Carlos. And also, I'm going to pass these comments to Dick and also expand them with some issues regarding maybe land use and so on. Well, first, the paper is clearly a good, I would say, almost a guide of transport modeling, and maybe the goal was to present a summarization of trends in transport modeling, and a broad presentation maybe limits some deepening of some aspects, which we could now go further. So some questions I would like to put here, and also by following Carlos' comments, could be so these questions could be raised on the process of transport planning and provision of demand, maybe. So I will make maybe 6 points, so feel free to choose among them on, well, or choose the ones that can be best managed with a complex systems approach. The influence of new technologies, technologies of information, the process of generation, the decision to make a trip or not to do it. I think it was good to your presentation makes a point here in teleworking, working on the move, teleshopping, and more delivered traffic. How can this be treated as inputs to modeling? This kinds of this new, what's new kinds of travel, or which are becoming more and more common. Second, you tell us about a tendency towards the adoption of activity-based models for travel demand provision. In which take into account the total activity pattern of a neighborhood of zones and so on, instead of the traditional fourth stage, the fourth step travel demand forecasting model. Could you explain this a little further, maybe with some examples of how this is being treated? And by the way, I think this is a good point to be made here in Brazil, because we seem to be doing good into infrastructure provision and new system, new transportation systems provision and building and operation, but regarding the efforts in demand management, we are still beginning. I think it would be a good point to stress here. We also see a trend towards the incorporation of urban and territorial variables in the LUT models. One of the issues that that we have to maybe we should discuss further is the participation of the real estate sector, the developers in the process of land use and occupation. In other words, the development of cities, because as I could read the paper, it seems that the LUT models work with the probability of conversion of land use, and not the act of, well, they are agent-based models to us to some extent, but not in its entirety, and there surely is a problem, because the decisions on urban development and where to build, where to decisions of locational decisions pose a problem of asymmetry of information. I'm not sure we are going to get this and to put into a model. So another problem in Brazil is that most of our master plans fail in the long term, because there are opportunistic decisions. You cannot be sure that some land that is developed is going to be used, and on the other side you have undeveloped land which is used before it's developed. Urbanization comes later. So, how can we deal with these issues in this kind of model, in the duality models? And now, the next is, as the process of transport planning and modeling are more and more complex, the same goes for a bigger need of information. And scarcity of information is a problem in poorer countries. So, I think maybe first we'd like to know how this process of generation of information on travel demand, for example, how does it work in the more developed countries? Do you have permanent process of data collecting, maybe part of the ordinary national censuses or other surveys, or do you still need dedicated origin destination research and dedicated specialized research, or can you already trust in a general system of information collecting at the household level? Sometimes it seems that we, in Latin America, we must build things from scratch. So, if we were to choose how to implement such a system of data collecting on travel demand, which do you think would be the best agencies to do for doing this if we were to begin from scratch? The next point is about the tax of private transportation of car or motorcycles ownership, which is an important variable in modal choice. We see it rising a lot in Brazil in the recent period, but we must also remember that car ownership does not mean necessarily to use this car. Maybe this is a question by Carlos. So, wouldn't you think it's more adequate to use variables on the effective use of cars complementary to the car ownership variables when modeling modal choice? And, well, my last point would be it's about another characteristic of most public transportation operations in Brazil, which have no public sponsors, public subsidies. That means most companies are private, especially buses, and the costs must be covered exclusively by the passengers who are paying for them. We see in the recent years that costs of transportation have been rising, of public transportation been rising well above the inflation prices in general. And that is a contrary trend when we take into account the private transportation, which is not rising so much, the cost of it. Surely it's causing impacts on the demand. How could we consider such different trends in the evolution of prices and of the costs of transportation in forecast and planning models? These variables are fundamental for model choice. So, how could we deal with them? Another thing that's very common in Brazil, especially in metropolitan areas where distances are longer, commute trips are longer. There's a trend toward a single ticket, a unit. You, regardless on how long you travel, you pay the same tax. And it seems to be related to a trend towards sprawling, towards urban sprawling. As we see another effort now of Minha Casa Minha Vida, of a public housing program, the results of 3 years of this program show that housing in states for the low wage are more and more distant from centers of jobs and urban amenities. I'm not trying here to prove that there isn't a link between this single ticket policy and the sprawling of cities, but anyway, maybe it should be good to know more about how are these things in more developed countries? If this if there is such a relation, maybe you could talk us a little more about this. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the thoughtful comments and questions. It's quite a list. Let's see how I can deal with this. Maybe take one thing first. You had a question about real estate markets and land use change and whether you can really talk about agents in a theoretical sense driving these processes. Also about why master plans fail in Brasilia and in Brazil and probably also in other places. If I take that together, that's basically the most difficult part in land use transportation modeling. So if it's about the travel component, the agents are straightforward and the behavior is reasonably straightforward. But decisions about land use change and urban development involve a variety of agents ranging from public authorities to real estate developers and all kind of other agents, which are not individual persons but are organizations, and that kind of behavior of those institutions is much more difficult to model and predict than the behavior of individuals. So, admittedly, developers of land use transport interaction models have been struggling with that. And the context makes a big difference, I think. In the Netherlands, for instance, urban development is very restricted. And in a sense, you wouldn't even have to model it because it is decided by policy where the developments will take place. So, in a sense, it makes life easier. Whereas in other places, it might be much more like a free market, where actually if you think there's sufficient demand for an urban development, you could plan it. But it differs from context to context. So anyway, and that's, I think, a more general comment for these agent-based models is that in theory it's very appealing to do everything agent-based, but in practice it's sometimes wiser to take some shortcut and use some econometric function, for instance, a hedonic model of land use prices or housing prices, instead of modeling the housing market with all its interactions to keep the model feasible and runnable. In a similar vein, I think in many cases, cellular automata have been used in combination with, and Bernardo is smiling because he did that also, in combination with transportation and maybe land use models, because they offer a more straightforward way of modeling urban development. In practice, you have to be practical and you have to, in the end, you want to have a model that gives some outcomes and hopefully good outcomes. So you may not want to wait until you have the perfect model to model these agents' behavior, because you will probably never get there. So it's better to make some clear assumptions about what will happen and maybe make some different scenarios for that and run those models. The same holds, I think, with the master plan. So if the master plan is made, you might assume that it occurs according to the master plan a bit, like the plans made in the Netherlands. But if it just works differently, again, you have to be practical and find a solution to that. So it's just a model, and the agents in the outside world might do different things. Or maybe you need other kind of analytical techniques, maybe qualitative techniques to investigate how models in, how agents in land use modeling and real estate development work. And based on that, you may develop certain scenarios. So that's about the land use development. There were some more explanatory questions for explanation, like activity-based model and how does it work. Car use and car ownership models. Yeah, let me start with activity-based models without going into the technological details. But what basically is the case that, like in a more conventional model, you have a model of trip generation or activity generation in this sense. So according to some probabilistic model, you predict that a household will or a person will do activities A, B, C, and D. And based on that, you will make, there's an algorithm that schedules the activities, and that can happen in different ways. It's less of a cookbook there. There are some more practical and more advanced models. But the idea is that once you have the activities, you come up with a sequence, with a schedule, and that will determine the timing of trips, the sequence of trips. You will allocate a travel mode, or choose a travel mode not for one single trip, but for a tour, for the whole tour of going to work, then to the shop, and then back home. So that's in a very basic sense how it works. We're going into the technicalities, but by doing that, you account for this interaction between activities. And for instance, one of the drivers of this development in the Netherlands was that at some point in the 90s, there was a shift in time regimes of shops that would normally be open until 6 o'clock in the evening, but that would be prolonged until 8 or 9 o'clock, and people were interested in would that have an effect on the temporal organization of our activities and our travel. And also because in response to congestion, people might also change their activity and traveling timing. And the other way around, if you want to have a good representation of how congestion builds up over time, you need to have a proper temporal dimension of travel. You cannot just say, I have so many cars per day or so many cars in the morning peak, because it matters whether someone will leave home at 7, at 7:30 or at 8. So those were drivers of the development of these activity-based models. The question about data availability, I skipped it because lack of time, but it is a valid question, a good question. What we have in the Netherlands is that we have, many countries have that, an annual household travel survey where individuals and households are, in the Netherlands at least, requested to for one particular day in the week, which is assigned, list all their trips and all their activities and all their travel modes. So if you have that, you can use that to validate your activity-based model and also to derive behavioral rules that will guide this activity scheduling process. It would be even better, of course, if you would have for multiple consecutive days, because then you can also look at variations from day to day. If you look at land use transport interaction models, I think what you ideally would want to have is sort of a panel where you report for a certain group of households for every year, where they are living, what their income is, how many cars they have, where they work, their household composition, etc., etc. Because then you can try to understand how decisions in one domain influence decisions in another domain, and also this temporal sequence might be associated with causal relationships. Although not always in the same, you may also take decisions in anticipation. It was not a panel study, but a retrospective survey where we asked these questions 10 years back. Mm-hmm. Because a panel is very expensive because you have to approach the same number of people every year. You have dropouts, you have to refill the panel, etc. So based on our data, we could look into the temporal development of these decisions, and we found that there are certain relationship between changing jobs and changing commute mode, between relocation and household events, etc., etc. So with those kind of data, you can, and we actually started doing that together with Harry Timmermans in Eindhoven, models that can take care of that part of the equation. Another thing is, if you really want to apply the model, you cannot only do it for the sample that you have, but you need to do it for some population to get the aggregation effects right. So what is typically done there is that modelers work with synthetic populations. So there are ways, if you know the aggregate distributions of the how many old and young people, how many different types of households, you can generate individual households synthetically in such a way that if you sum them all up, the marginal distributions of that zone, for instance, are met. And that could be a basis for agent-based modeling that's typically done. I hope that more or less answered your question. Do you want me to go into something more specifically?
I think it's okay. We may open to the floor a little bit. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Glenn, for your comments and answers. So is there anybody who would like to have a question? One here, one there. Okay, please. The microphone is coming.
And good evening to everyone. My name is Alexandre. I work in Metro DF. I have one question to Mr. Etema about the composition of households in the city, the complexity of the city, and about the social groups. Okay, I think this households is more than a single household in transportation modeling and activity based, because the social groups. Many social groups may behave like a household when people link together to combine many activities to do along the city. And I have another question too about the lifestyle of people. And when a government makes some politics that influences the people who have some lifestyle and propensity to consume some good, like car, if the government stimulates the industry, automobilistic industry, some people who have the lifestyle oriented to consume car will consume car, and that make take some issue to the cities like congestion. And how is the lifestyle is addressed in the modeling?
Okay, thank you.
Just a second. Let's get the second question, and we answer in a bunch, and then I think it's more effective. Here, there's another one.
Good afternoon, Victor Celestino from Fundação Exut. You mentioned twice cell automata, and that made me curious of how would you actually use it. I don't have any experience with urban transportation, but only air traffic control, and I know the NextGen project in the U.S., the FAA, is actually using cell automata to model each sector where the air traffic would move. Again, I would like you to give some more information about how to use cellular automata in transportation modeling. And how would you actually calibrate the rules of these cellular automata in order to make the model more readable, more feasible?
Very good, yes.
Good question.
Anybody else? Yeah? No? Dick, please.
Okay. First question about social groups. I'm not sure if I properly understood that, but are you meaning that
behind, apart from households, you have other social groups like social networks.
I think it's more like low income and high income, average income people. Like poorer people uses the matter more often. Yes.
Oh, that's okay. And how you deal with that in modeling?
Yes.
Yeah, it's if it's just income, it's somewhere in I mentioned this process of making synthetic populations. So if you have data about a certain neighborhood and the income distribution in that neighborhood, you can synthesize a population of households, and some will have low incomes and some will have high incomes, like in the previous presentation where you had an income distribution in every neighborhood. So you could mimic that in your model, and your the income of these households might affect decisions about car ownership and the amount of travel to do, sensitivity to fuel prices or fares, but also decisions about car ownership, etc. And if you run your model, you could also single out the outcomes for different social groups, so to speak. So you could get an insight in the implications of certain policies for different social groups. What might be more complicated is that, of course, income, to stick with that, is not constant over time. People may develop a career. They may lose their job and drop in income, triggering all kind of decisions about get rid of your car, have to go to a smaller dwelling, etc. So if you do that, well, you need a representation in your model of what is a normal income development for an average person in a certain group, for instance, given his or her education. Again, that's an example of this ever-increasing complexity. You have to decide whether you want to do that. But if you say that agent-based models are dynamic and they run over multiple years, it's probably not realistic to assume that incomes will be stable all the time. About lifestyle, you can interpret that in two ways. One is the more factual lifestyle in terms of the activities you engage in and the places you go, and how that influences people's response to policies. For instance, you talked about car ownership. That's an important one. So if you aspire or have a very outgoing lifestyle where you see many friends and do many things and have to combine many activities, then you could say that's a sort of a lifestyle to which car is more attractive. I'm not sure to what extent that is incorporated in current car ownership models. Probably not, but maybe that's something you might want to take into account. You could also regard lifestyle in a more psychological and attitudinal sense. And you mentioned car ownership also in that respect. And also their lifestyles and attitudes might change. So there's some emerging evidence in Western European and countries and in the United States that young people's attitudes towards the car is changing. In the 60s, 70s, the car was a status symbol. It's not anymore. Young people, at least that's the story, see the car as a practical thing and derive social status from their smartphone. So that sort of lifestyle, if it changes, will also have an effect on people's decision. Of course, that's much more difficult to account for, but if you run your model 10, 20 years ahead, I mean, you should keep it somewhere in the back of your mind that social conventions might change also in other domains, like the status of working or task allocation in households. But it's difficult, I think, to grasp in models of this kind. The cellular automata, that's a tricky one. I've never used them myself, but I have read about how they did it in the Netherlands. And basically, yeah, what was the problem there is that they developed some behavioral rules for these cells to change their function. But if they just let run the model freely, it wouldn't work. It would totally reconfigure our Dutch urban system, so to speak. So that's not totally realistic. So they put a lot of restrictions on the model in such a sense that it was run more by the restrictions than by the behavioral rules of the cells. So yeah, that is a problem. And calibration, what I saw there is also very problematic. What they did there was that they just ran the model, let's say, 1,000 times each time with slightly different specifications of the parameters in the model to see which specific specification was best able to mimic the actual Dutch land use. That's a very expensive way of doing it, I guess. I'm not totally sure how they do it in other areas. I think Bill Rent, he told me he worked with the sloop model. Maybe they did something like that. So he may tell you, give you more information on that. But as said, it's not as an excuse. My experience more on the behavioral side of things, not so much on the land use. But that's what I learned about it.
Okay. Thank you very much. Anybody else? Yeah. Okay. So thank you very much for your presentation, Dick. Thank you,
Cleandro.
Yep. Okay. Before I close the seminar, we have some space for closing comments. So the speakers, especially Bill, talked earlier.